So this is the recording room. This is where everything's happening when we record the mice.
It's true. This lab in the Bryan Research Building on Duke University's campus does not look like a recording studio.
Those cages and those very fancy microphones that can capture the ultrasounds. So we have 12 boxes, and this computer is actually plugged to each individual microphone and can record 12 channels at a time.
So can you say this is the recording studio?
This is the recording studio, basically, yes.
And record they do. And not just any songs. Sweet, almost haunting love songs.
So we call these sexy songs. The meaning in here in the case is like a male showing that he can produce the complex sounds that makes him attractive for mating.
And now, meet the recording stars who perform these lilting love ballads. Here they are, the mice. That's right, mice. Everybody knows the little creatures squeak. Duke researchers discovered the male mice sing, and it's only the males who break into song, and those songs are all about love.
And we found that the only context, behavioral context, that got these mice to produce what we call songs reliably is anything related to a female. All right, female urine, the presence of a female. And so that convinced us, even more than in the past studies, that these songs are meant for courtship behavior.
Yep, male mice sing silly love songs.
And this is what it does when you pair it with the video and the sonograms in real time with the fresh female urine.
And just like people, the type of love song depends on the context. Researchers recorded male mice when they were roaming around their cages, when they were exposed to the smell of female urine, and when they were placed in the presence of a female mouse. It turns out the songs are louder and more complex when the male mouse smells a female and is looking for her, but doesn't see her.
The females prefer these more complex syllables over these simple ones. Yeah. That is, if you play them from a speaker, in their hearing range, of course, the females will spend more time by the speaker playing the more complex songs than the simple ones. And we don't know, we don't think that means anything semantically, like an object.
Right.
But we think it just sounds more like if you listen to a jazz singer. One singer sounds more sexier than the other.
But watch what happens when a female mouse is added to the cage. The songs get longer and simpler when the two mice are together.
And the male is actually more focusing on trying to chase her than actually producing very complex sounds.
He was singing these complex syllables when she was on the other side of the cage. And then when she comes near or he's chasing her, he switches to the simple ones in real time. I just noticed that a few minutes ago.
You hadn't noticed that before?
No.
The discovery puts mice in a pretty elite group of animal vocalizers. Think birds and whales and dolphins. But don't try to listen for the songs of love-struck mice. The little singers harmonize in the ultrasonic range, too high-pitched for the human ear.
If you're looking at the frequency here, it's definitely, so it's starting at 40K, which is 40 kilohertz, and it goes up, it can go up to 100 kilohertz.
The human hearing range is around 15 kilohertz. A special microphone is needed to record the mouse songs, which are played back at a lower frequency.
So why study singing mice? Well, it turns out mice vocalization is a model for studying autism. In humans, autism limits speech, becomes very limited, very monotone, and the same thing happens with autistic mice. Trouble is, we don't understand enough about mice vocalizations, the behavior, the brain pathways, to really apply it very well to humans yet.
Researchers have already found that mice with a genetic variant sometimes seen in autism have what could be called stunted squeaks, and those stunted squeaks could be used as models for studying nonverbal autistic individuals who have problems uttering words.
We can now characterize the mouse vocal behavior, and we're getting into the brain as well, better so that we can actually be more informed of what to look for and how to study the mechanisms of autism in a mouse. And so we're trying to test the limits of the mouse vocalization system as a model to understand human vocal behavior. So that's one reason why I think it's important. The second is, I think it's just important to understand the biology of the animals around us. It helps us understand nature a lot better and get a better appreciation of it and of our own selves.